For the first leg of my trip, I'm heading out along the shores of the Gulf of Thailand to the sprawling metropolis of Bangkok. From there, I'll head north again through Lopburi in Thailand's central plains before climbing into the peaks of the Thai highlands to the ancient city of Chiang Mai. There are a dozen trains that take passengers to Bangkok every day. When you get to the station, it's a bit of a rush. You've only got a few minutes to grab your stuff and get on board. The state runs the trains in Thailand. They have 250 locomotives in their fleet. Most are at least 40 years old, but they're workhorses. Exactly what's needed to battle Thailand's punishing terrain and weather. Made in France, this Alstom locomotive is 16.2 meters long, 3.9 meters high, and 2.8 meters wide. It's powered by a 2,400 horsepower diesel-electric engine. It'll be pulling six carriages with 138 passengers. With a top speed of only 95 kilometers an hour, Thai trains aren't built for speed, more like tanks ready for battle. We just left the train station in Surathani, taking our time getting out of town. Soon we'll be up at a much faster clip, and we've got a long way to go. My journey starts on Thailand's Southern Line. At over 1,000 kilometers, it's the longest in the entire country. Southern Line was completed in the early 1920s. It connected Bangkok, Singapore, and Malaysia, and it resulted in the first real tourist boom for Thailand. But it's not just tourists riding the train. Third-class carriages are most popular with locals and backpackers. There's no assigned seats and just a rickety fan blowing hot air. But fares are cheap. A third-class ticket from Surathani to Bangkok will set you back 217 Thai baht, just over $9 Canadian. Lots of different classes and types of cabins on this train, so the seating in each are often very different. Second class appeals to the flashpacker set, travelers willing to spend more for comfortable seating and air conditioning. A ticket here will cost you almost $28 Canadian. As far as first class, well, there is none.
Chiang Mai, huh?
50 million people ride these trains every year.
I want all the passengers to enjoy their trip.
In remote rural areas where there are no signals, drivers have to grab a right-of-way token to be allowed to drive on the section of track ahead.
We have the right-of-way for this section of the rail till the next station. We're the only train traveling on this section.
If there's no token available, the driver has to stop at the next pullover to wait for the track to clear.
This is to prevent any collisions.
When the right-of-way train gets to the next station, the driver drops off the token for the next available train to pick up. As we get ready to pull into Chumphung Station,
right now I'm on the hunt for something to eat.
I get to see another Thai train tradition. Food vendors coming right up to the windows. If you do get off to buy something, be careful. The train doesn't stop for long, and you don't want to be left behind.
Almost didn't make it there.
400 kilometers south of Bangkok, we're traveling along the Gulf of Thailand, an area that relies heavily on tourism and agriculture.
Now we're in the south of the country. It's flat, mostly rice fields and forest.
Vegetation in this tropical climate grows fast, so fast that even in between trimmings, it can overtake the tracks. That uproots rails, throwing everything off level. Not only does this mean a bumpy ride, the undercarriages take such a beating that chassis have to be replaced every year. Even with regular maintenance, driving one of these powerful machines is a challenge, especially in monsoon season.
It's raining and there may be flooding ahead.
Monsoon season can last up to 5 months, battering rail lines with tropical storms, gale force winds, and flash floods.
The rain is not heavy yet. I think we can pass through it.
As day turns to night, the rain gets heavier. Train staff are on high alert, but their tools are extremely low tech.
I'm using a flashlight to check the water level along the rail to see if the level of the water is getting higher.
When traveling across flooded tracks, the faster the speed, the higher the water kicks up. If it splashes too high, it gets into the traction motors. That can cause a short circuit, stopping the motors and crippling the entire train.
The water is higher than 10 centimeters above the track. We have to stop, as the systems below the train are all electrical parts.
As water around the track rises, our train grinds to a halt. We're stranded in the middle of the Thai wilderness, causing alarm at traffic control.
For traffic control operations, flooding on a scale that stops the trains is one of the biggest challenges we face.
And dispatcher Purish has already experienced the worst in Thailand's history. In 2011, severe monsoons washed out nearly all of North and Central Thailand. More than 85% of the country was considered a disaster zone. 815 people died, and more than 13 million were affected.
It was a natural disaster that we will all remember.
Total damage to the rail lines was more than 125 million Canadian dollars. On our trek, the rain starts to let up, and we're given the go-ahead to start rolling again. We crawl ahead at a reduced speed, while the train crew prepares for higher water levels and worst-case scenarios.
We have to stop and coordinate with the station on how to evacuate the passengers and get them to their destinations.
Hanya is the train master. He supervises the entire train and the card men who work under him.
I have to check the tickets and give the signals at the station for passengers to get on and off. I have to take care of the safety of the passengers and make sure everything is in order.
We're making our way slowly into Bang Sapan, 7 hours south of Bangkok. It's partway through our trip. We're just coming up to a station here. We're about to stop. With passengers and local villagers using the station as shelter from the rains, the cardmen's job is complex. And you know, it's interesting traveling around the world by train. It's incredible how fast and easily we get from station to station. To overcome language barriers with international passengers, cardmen rely on a simple two-color system.
Now we're giving the red signal for passengers to get on and off. When all the passengers have boarded, then I will give the green light signal.
Blink and you could miss the green light, not to mention the train entirely. We actually got to get back on now because they're about to go.